right, good morning, everybody. Been a minute since I've been here. First song we're going to sing is Go Tell It on the Mountain. If everybody could please stand.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, or silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel's chorus that hailed our Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lonely manger, the humble Christ was born. And God sent us salvation that blessed the Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
God, we just thank you for this day. We listen to those words where we're supposed to go tell it on the mountain. Not that you're just that you were born, but that you are salvation, you are life, you are our everything. We just thank you for what you did for us on the cross and your resurrection too, and thank you for this time that we can praise and worship you. Just thank you for loving us, in Jesus' name, amen.
All right, you may be seated. Good morning. Start with a couple of quick announcements here at the beginning. First one is Pastor is not here this morning, so Brian Cribbs will be filling in for him. See what else. Lottie Moon Christmas box, that's an insert in your bulletin here. And what it is with internal Christmas cards, if you want to drop those in there, and the money you save in postage, you would be sent into those people, donate to the Lottie Moon Christmas Fund, or you can just do it even if you don't have postage money. Also, Blue Christmas is coming up at the Harrisonville Community Center. The Ministerial Alliance is putting that on, and Clayton will be speaking at that. It's time for people who are grieving and mourning the death of a loss. I guess that's grieving. They're just gathering to pray and comfort them as churches. And that's on December 9th at 4 o'clock, not 4:30, 4 o'clock at the Harrisonville Community Center. We will not be having service tonight. And we'll have Ring of Fire as always. And did I hear we are not doing men's breakfast? No, I made that up. Okay. It was in the text. No men's breakfast. All right. No men's breakfast this week. And then we will have a Ring of Fire Christmas celebration on December 13th. Does anybody have a birthday or an anniversary you'd like to share with us today? All right. Well, then we'll get on with worship.
All right, next song we're going to sing is O Holy Night, page 194.
Stand up.
Please stand.
O Holy Night, the stars are brightly shining. It is the night of the dear Savior's birth. Long lay the world in sin and ever pining, till He appeared and the soul felt its worth. A thrill of hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn. Fall on your knees, oh,
song we're singing is Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee.
Flowering meadow, flashing
I just clipped it in the wrong spot. I'll hold it for now. Sorry, guys. Is that better? Okay. All right. Any prayer requests? Charles? Carissa? Okay. 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 So she got out, did she just have a surgery of some sort, or? Okay. Yep. Pray for healing for Chris. And this is your niece, you said?
One of my best friends.
Oh, okay. Best friend's niece, okay. All right, gotcha. Certainly. Anybody else? Yep.
Pray for me and John. Our truck was stolen last week.
Yeah.
And the insurance will only give it 10 days, business days, and they'll total it out. So next Friday we'll know more information.
Total it out, meaning you got it back or they found
no,
it?
No, they're going to total the truck out. It doesn't be found.
Oh, okay, gotcha. Okay.
Yeah.
I hope he drove it off a cliff or something. Well, I hate to say that. Hopefully it broke down on him.
Yeah.
Whoever did. There you go. That's better. Okay. Yeah. Okay. You said Sandra?
Sandra.
Okay. 4 months to live? Is that what you said? 4 months to live?
4 to 6 months.
4 to 6 months. Okay. Okay, certainly. Where does she live around here?
Or? No, she's in Georgia.
Georgia. Okay. Okay. All right. Well, we'll pray that first and foremost healing, but also just peace and comfort. Yeah. Yeah. Anybody else? Oh, yeah.
My cousin, Haley,
okay.
She is a sophomore in high school. She's having issues with her shin, the muscles, and the lower part of her leg.
Okay.
She was on crutches and stuff for a while, and she's one that plays all the sports.
Yeah. This has come on pretty sudden. I mean, it's not like a...
something to do with shin splints and stuff.
Yeah.
It's more severe than that, so.
Okay. I've had shin splints. That hurts. Okay. And this is your cousin, you said?
My cousin's daughter.
Cousin's daughter. Okay. Yep. Also, if I learned of two people just in the last week that either committed suicide or attempted it. It's another huge ongoing problem where people think life isn't worth living. I have a friend from high school. I just found out just the other day that he hung himself. He was not a close friend of mine, but kind of a friend of friends, you know, high school classmate. Hadn't seen him in years, but I don't know his life for the last 20 years, but it always hurts to hear something like that. And then my wife has someone she knows from work that attempted his own life and may still lose it. I mean, we'll pray for him, but He's in bad shape. Yeah. Yep. Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, evil's growing more evil, but we know we're going to be victorious. We are victorious. Yes. Okay. Nothing else? I'll start prayer? All right. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you listen to us, that you care enough for us. Lord, our problems seem so minor a lot of times compared to what's going on in this world, but nothing's too minor for you. You care about us. You love us. And we just thank you for hearing us, Lord. Please, these requests that we've heard today, we ask for prayer for each of these people. So we've got Carissa. We ask that you give her healing, that give the doctors godly wisdom. They may not be godly doctors, but we know you can give wisdom to anybody, and we ask for that for her. We ask that you heal her. Please take away pain. Please take away discomfort. Please stop the cancer. But Lord, please work in her life. Minister to her. Please show her your love, that you do exist. Please make that very known to her. And we ask that in your name. Christy and John, Lord, their truck, it's rough. We need transportation, Lord. We ask that you make things right with them and make things right. We ask for quickly. We know it's your time and we commit to your time, but we ask that it be resolved quickly, Lord, that they can get their wheels back soon and bless them in that whole process, Lord, that things are made right financially for them. And they find the right vehicle for them. Sandra, Lord, another cancer situation. We know that you can heal, and we ask for that for her. Please take away the pain. Please take away the disease, the illness. Please take away the cancer. That's our first request, Lord. But we know that you have plans in her life. You have plans for her family and their life. But Lord, please minister in that family and show them your love. Please show them your peace and your hand upon them. And be with them through this whole deal, Lord. But we ask that you bless her and take care of her. Kelly's friend Haley. Lord, whatever's going on with her legs, please heal her of this. Please take away the pain. You obviously gifted her with athleticism. You gifted her with a talent, Lord, that we hope that she can use to glorify you. And in order to do that, it helps to have some healthy legs. So Lord, please please heal her and bring rehab to her pretty quickly, Lord. And give them wisdom, Lord, to let them know what it is, what's causing this. You're our healer, you're our doctor, and we seek you first, and we hope that she seeks you first as well. We thank you for this day. Lord, please bless the pastor and his family, Janice and the kids. They need rest. Please, whatever they're doing, wherever they're at, please keep evil away. Please bless their time. Give them rest and peace. We thank you, and please work with him, Lord, in leading and guiding. Please guide his steps. We thank you for our time today. We ask that you bless and take care of those who couldn't be here. Give me the words to speak, Father. You give me a message, and please allow me to to get everything out that you want out. Thank you for it. Thank you for everything, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
For offertory, we're going to sing Higher Ground. If everybody could please stand.
Pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table. Some may dwell where these abound. My prayer, my aim is higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table in a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to starts at me are hurled, for faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table. Scale the utmost heights and catch a gleam of glory bright. But
All right, for today's worship song, I want to do one that we did a few weeks back. We're going to sing 10,000 Reasons.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Well, bless the Lord, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. You're rich in love and You're slow to for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh, worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing Your praise. In years and then forever more. Well, bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship Your holy name. Yes, I worship Your holy name. Yes, I worship Your holy
name. Can everybody hear me okay now? I can switch to a regular mic. Not this mic, this mic. All right. Well, it's been a while since I've been up here. The pastor doesn't take very many vacations. He usually backs out when he threatens to. But I'm glad he got one. He needs it. I needs a rest. We're not doing the Advent. That seems loud now. Does that seem loud? We're good? Okay, sorry. I like jumped up. All right, so we're not doing the Advent candles. We kind of jumped the gun last week. I think Pastor just loves to play with candles. No, he wanted to do it. You know, he knew he wasn't going to be here today. But we went ahead and lit our first candle of Advent last week, which was hope. So, of course, next week we'll do our next candle, which would be peace. But if I could add another candle, it's not really, I don't get to, they don't let me do it, but if I could add another one at this time of year, I would say I would add one that's called the Voice of God, or the Listen candle, if you will. So why do I say this time of year? Because this time of year is very noisy. It's a great celebratory time. We have a lot of fun, a lot of festivities, Christmas parties, get-togethers, music programs at school, Christmas shopping, a lot of laughter, conversations, a lot going on. You know, listening to kids talk about their Christmas lists and showing me the Bass Pro catalog saying, Dad, this is what I want for Christmas. But it can be fun, but nonetheless, it's still noise and it's still stress. So today, I prayerfully asked the Lord what he wants me to talk about. You know, when the pastor says, can you fill the pulpit, I have no idea. You know, I'm not going to continue his series. That would be horrible. I would definitely not do it justice. My messages to you are usually not a deep theological essay. I'm more of what they call a sermonette for the Christianette, if you will. But I always prayerfully ask the Lord what he would like me to talk about. So my messages a lot of times are usually good lessons for myself, messages that I myself need to hear. It's funny how he does that. But when I sat down in prayer, I asked him, Lord, what would you like me to bring to the folks on Sunday? And I just kept thinking, listen. Well, okay, I'm listening. What do you got? Listen. No, listen. Oh, I get it. Maybe more of us need that message, that we need to listen. So my life is very busy. I've got 3 kids. We've got a lot of family get-togethers. I travel for work quite a bit. I've been working an hour and 20 minutes away every day lately, and then I'm getting ready to go to southern Missouri for a few days. So we got softball games, basketball games, football games, so a lot of noise, a lot of stress, a lot of it's fun, but I don't get a whole lot of quiet time unless I make an effort. And that's part of my problem is I don't make the effort I need to. I'll sit there and watch TV, but I could be having my quiet time then. So I think it's very important that we learn how to listen. Why is it important? Why is it important that we listen to what God has to say for us? Well, that's a pretty stupid question. Why would I not want to hear what my maker, the creator of the universe, has to say? Obviously, we want to know. We want to hear from our Lord. So anyway, there's several scriptures that support why we would want to do so. James 1:19 says, "So then, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath." James also says in 4:8, "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you." We need to be near him if we're going to listen to him. Proverbs 19:27, "Cease listening to instruction, my son, and you will stray from the words of knowledge." Got to listen. Matthew 7:24, "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock." And that's where I want my house. but I've got to hear him. I've got to listen. And then the most popular one, Romans 10:7. So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. So it's important for instruction. We need to hear. Arrowhead Stadium is, I guess, still probably the loudest stadium. I think that was a fact. They did the decibel test. But opposing teams, when they come to Arrowhead Stadium, they have a hard time hearing play calls. They have a hard time hearing the coach, the quarterback. It's very hard. There's a lot of noise going on. There's a lot of yelling, screaming, cursing, a lot of distraction. So it's very hard. So it's very, very important that we listen so we can hear the instructions. We need to know the plays. We need to know the plays from our Lord. We need to listen. There's a little clip here. Dr. Chapman, are you in there? Would you be able to play that for me? This is a clip from a movie. I'm a baseball nut. This is a good example of why it's important to hear so we can focus. So instruction, and we also need to focus. He says, clear the mechanism. So he needs to clear the noise. We've got to clear the noise from our life. So we've talked about why it's important. I want to talk about how we can clear the mechanism, how we can get rid of, thank you, Chapman, how we can get rid of the distraction, the noise in our life, especially this time of year. So how can we hear from God? Psalm 46:10 says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Isaiah 55:3, incline your ear and come to me. Hear and your soul shall live, and I will make an everlasting covenant with you. The sure mercies of David. So the best example that we can follow would be Jesus Christ. Lots of examples of Jesus and how he cleared the mechanism. Jesus, on the night of his betrayal, he went into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. Matthew 26:36 says, then Jesus came with them to a place called Gethsemane and said to the disciples, sit here while I go and pray over there. So you sit here while I go over there. When Jesus was preaching in Galilee, Mark 1:35 says, now in the morning, having risen a long time while before daylight, he went out and departed to a solitary place, and there he prayed. Right before feeding the 5,000 with bread and fish, in Matthew 14, says, when Jesus heard it, he departed from there by boat to a deserted place by himself. And then same story in Mark, he's telling it, 6:30, says, then the apostles gathered to Jesus and told him all things, both what they had done and what they had taught, and he said to them, come aside by yourselves to a deserted place and rest a while. For there were many coming and going, and they did not even have time to eat. So they departed to a deserted place in the boat by themselves. By themselves. Right after that, he sent his disciples on a boat, and then he retreated. Mark 6:45 says, he immediately made his disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side, to Bethsaida, while he sent the multitude away. And when he had sent them away, he departed to the mountain to pray. Luke 5:16 says, talking about Jesus, himself would often withdraw into the wilderness and pray. I notice the key words often and wilderness. So often he left to go pray. So this should not be a something we do at Christmas time. You know, let's say December 12th, I'm going to go out in the woods and pray. This is something we need to do often. It's not just a New Year's resolution thing. I'm gonna get away and listen to the Lord. It's not a quarterly thing, an annual thing. It's, no, often. We need to often do it. And I noticed the word wilderness. So it didn't say he went into the other room or he went into his closet. You got to get away from everything. If I go into my room and try to do anything like that, I'm going to get a knock on the door. Dad, so-and-so took my whatever. Dad, can I go do this? Or I hear noises. I got to get away. I got to go away. And that also means getting away from this. We may not have much wilderness around here, but we do need to get away. Luke 6:12 says, "Now it came to pass in those days that he went out to the mountain to pray and continued all night in prayer to God." So again, he's going out. He's going out to the mountains, the gardens, the wilderness, the woods. And I do think it helps too. I do think it really helps to go for a walk. Get outside. Look at God's majesty. Look at his beauty. Get away from the noise, the traffic, the sirens, the phone, the TV, the radio. You know, I have a bad habit of getting in the car, immediately turn on the radio. It's usually already on. Sometimes it's music. Sometimes it's talk radio. Sometimes it's bot radio. It's all, you know, it's good, but I've always got it on. I've got to learn to shut it off. So how do we hear? So there's different ways that we can hear from God. We can hear it audibly, through an audible voice. And if you have your Bibles, you could turn to 1 Samuel 3. I think Pastor Clayton talked on this not too long ago. 1 Samuel chapter 3, starting in verse 1. Talking about Samuel when he was young. He heard from the Lord. "Now the boy Samuel ministered to the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was rare in those days. There was no widespread revelation. And it came to pass at that time, while Eli was lying down in his place, and when his eyes had begun to grow so dim that he could not see, and before the lamp of God went out in the tabernacle of the Lord where the ark of God was, and while Samuel was lying down, that the Lord called Samuel, and he answered, 'Here I am.' So he ran to Eli and said, 'Here I am, for you called me.' And he said, 'I did not call. Lie down again.' And he went and lay down. Then the Lord called yet again, 'Samuel.' So Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, 'Here I am, for you called me.' He answered, 'I did not call, my son. Lie down again.' Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, nor was the word of the Lord yet revealed to him. And the Lord called Samuel again the third time. So he arose and went to Eli and said, 'Here I am, for you did call me.' Then Eli perceived that the Lord had called the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, 'Go lie down, and it shall be, if he calls you, that you must say, "Speak, Lord, for your servant hears." So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood and called as at the other times, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel answered, "Speak, for your servant hears." And I won't go on, but read the whole chapter later, but about what he has to say. But the important thing is open your ears. It may not be who you think it is. Lost my place here. So I'm not going to claim that I know how God chooses certain forms of communication. That's his will. He's got reasons for everything and how he communicates to us. But I speculate that, you know, in those days, in biblical times, that the physical Bible, this was not readily available. You know, they didn't have a handy-dandy devotional that they got from the local bookstore. They did have priests like Eli that could help guide and instruct using the word. They did have God's audible voice, which we also can have now. Later on, Christians had God in the flesh walking the earth. That were, you know, Jesus was here. He was instructing and he was ministering. But today, Jesus gifted us with the Holy Spirit. He can still use an audible voice, but he gave us the Holy Spirit. So in another reading, John, if you want to turn to John chapter 16, talk about when he gave us the Holy Spirit. John 16, verse 7, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not, or the Holy Spirit will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you. And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment because the ruler of this world is judged. I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth, for he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak. And he will tell you the things to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore I said that he will take of mine and declare it to you." So we have a channel directly from God through the Holy Spirit. He gets his message from God, gives it to us. We have that today. In John chapter 10, so we have the Holy Spirit. We have an audible voice that can be possible. I have not personally heard it that I know of. Maybe. Some have. I've definitely have heard from the Holy Spirit. The Word is another source that we can hear. John chapter 10, verse 27 says, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one." 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work." And then again, Romans 10, 17, "So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God." So we can hear through this. John Piper said, "Do you want to hear God speak? Read your Bible out loud. You'll hear him speak." We can also hear through fellow believers. Could be Pastor Clayton. Could be Dr. Chapman. Fellow believers. A lot of times God has spoken to me through other people, other believers in my life. Fellow brothers in Christ, sisters in Christ. God gives us messages to relay to one another. So Samuel was guided by Eli on hearing the correct voice. He didn't have the he didn't know who the voice was. Eli, he guided him on that. So we want to be around others who are regularly in God's word. If we know some folks that are in God's word regularly, those are people we want to hear from. We want to talk to. Gee, where could we find such people? James 3:17 says, "But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy." Another way we could hear from the Lord is through signs and wonders. Mark 16:19 through 20 says, "So then after the Lord had spoken to them, he was received up into heaven and sat down at the right hand of God. And they went out and preached everywhere, the Lord working with them and confirming the word through the accompanying signs." Amen. We can also hear through music, worship, prayer. We were singing 10,000 reasons, or 10,000, reasons. Yeah, I was like, that didn't sound right. Yeah, we can hear him through our worship, through music, through prayer. Romans 8, 26 through 28. It says, likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groaning which cannot be uttered. Now he who searches the hearts knows what the mind of the Spirit is, because he makes intercession for the saints according to the will of God. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. So, a lot of different ways we can hear from the Lord. How do we know we've heard from God? I saw an interesting article by Andrew Wilson. I've just took part of the article on how we can, it was a good filter, a way that we can kind of filter what we've heard, whether we know it's from the Lord or not. He says, first we can check that we're hearing against what the Holy Spirit has revealed in Scripture. If someone feels led to leave his wife and run off with someone else, then we know he's been deceived, simply because the Spirit won't contradict what he said in the Bible. That's our source. Second, we can check it against what we know of Jesus. Is it arrogant, lustful, greedy, divisive? Then it's not the Word of God. You'd be amazed how many bogus words from God can be debunked simply by running them through these two filters. Is it biblical? Does it go against what Jesus would have done or would do? Third, talk to teachers about it. Leaders. Leaders are not priests, and they are certainly not infallible, but the New Testament describes them as those who guide and teach the church. Paul heard from God pretty clearly, but he still talked a lot about the responsibility of leaders to correct those who were talking rubbish. If you're a leader, his instructions are fairly simple. Don't quench the Spirit. Don't despise prophecies. Test everything. Hold fast to the good. Fourth, Paul talks in 1 Corinthians 14 about prophecy being weighed or judged by the church. This means the local church, together. We need to exercise discernment and wisdom when people prophesy. Is this person trustworthy? Is this word from God? And if it is, how weighty is it? Finally, we simply consider the effect or the fruit of what we think God is saying. Both Moses and Paul offer us some great common sense. Does the word cause people to rebel against God and serve idols? Then it's not from God. Does it fail to come true? Then it's not from God. Does it cause people to see Jesus as Lord? Then it's from the Holy Spirit. Does it edify Christians and cause unbelievers to worship God? Then it's from the Holy Spirit. When God speaks, it will come true. Glorify Jesus, prompt worship, encourage people, and build up the church. If those things aren't happening, it's not from God. A few weeks back, Derek Rishmawi wrote a great article here on the principle of abasus non tollit usum. Abuse does not take away use. In a few areas of the Christian life, is this point more important than in hearing from God? Yes, there are countless examples out there of silliness, nonsense, and oddity. But despite those examples, we need to remember that the New Testament church is an eschatological, spirit-filled, prophetic voice of God hearing people, and we get to be a part of it. God speaks and we hear. What a privilege. So, I encourage all of you in the next few days. Yeah, I'm already wrapping up. I know there's no Chiefs game afterwards, but it's what I've got. In the next few days, I encourage you guys to turn off the TV, shut off the radio, even the Christmas music, especially Taylor Swift. Please turn it off. Leave your phone behind. Put on your thermals, your coat, your hat, and your mittens, maybe even muck boots lately. Go for a walk. Go for a walk in the woods. Find a lake. Go to Lord's Park. Go to the City Lake Park. Whatever. Pray all you want to pray, all you need to pray, all that you have for the Lord. But also tell him, speak for your servant hears. And then you guys know the rest. Listen. But we have to do it not only at Christmas time, but we have to do it often, as our Lord did. That's all I got. Homework assignment. I'm going to ask you guys, did you go for a walk? Get out. Okay. Well, I'm going to close in prayer. Dear Father, thank you for the gifts that you've given us. Thank you for the gift of your Son to pay the penalty for our sin. We couldn't fulfill the law, but you did so through Christ. Lord, thank you for the gift of the Holy Spirit. He's our helper. He's our guide. And we need to hear from him. We need to hear from you, Lord. We want to hear from you. We're sorry that we become so distracted and we have so much going on in our lives that we can't take 15 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes to sit there quietly and prayerfully seek you and listen to you. We know you have plans for us, Lord. We need instruction. We need focus. But we need our comforter. And we thank you for being those things for us, Lord. Please bless this us in these times. It is great joy and excitement. A lot of festivities and fellowship. It can also be a tough time for many. Many have lost people at this time of year. We ask that you ease their suffering, Lord. Please give them peace and comfort right now. And give them the joy that supersedes everything. It's true joy. Even through sadness and despair, we can have the true joy that only comes from you. Lord, please bless those in these times. Please keep us all safe. Please keep evil far from this church, far from your people. Please bless those overseas in the Middle East, Lord, that are facing some persecution and death and hard times, Lord. Please bless your people there. And Father, help us to keep everything in perspective, that it's you, Jesus first. And if we seek you, everything else will follow. Thank you for all this. In Jesus' heavenly name, amen. Got a closing song? Awesome.
All right, if everybody could please stand, we're going to sing Room at the Cross.
The cross upon which Jesus died is a shelter in which we can hide. His grace so free is sufficient for me, and deep in its fountain, as wide as the sea, there's room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have room at the cross for you. Oh, millions have found him a friend and have turned from the sins they have sinned. The Savior still waits to open the gates and welcome the sinner. Room at the cross for you. There's room at the cross for you. Though millions have come, there's still room for one.
Pray for Jim. Guys or someone, we can all come up here and pray for him this week.
Thank you, guys.
Yes.
We love you.
God, we just lift Jim up here to you. You are the ultimate physician. We leave him in your hands. You can take everything, pain away right now if you want. We trust you in the plan for his life, plan for this week. Just give him faith, give him strength, give him trust. There's nothing to fear because we have you. God, we just, again, we just praise you for this eternal hope that we have. Again, we just pray for his healing. Just go with us this week. We know you're here right now, and we just lift him up to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yep. And pray for the doctors, too, because they're going to need it.
Yeah. Thank you.
And it's time.